This can cause a panic.
It is difficult to accept that we are not the only civilization, that there is intelligence besides us, and the proof of this is the abundance of artifacts that are carefully hidden from the public. If I were lying, I would have written a more sophisticated story about aliens, but I don't have any motivation to lie.
Hello, my dear subscribers and channel viewers. What do you know about
Area 51?
What do you know about Bob Lazar? Let's try to figure it out.
Who is Bob Lazar? A provocateur and liar, or really a person who has visited Area 51 and participated in the research of flying saucers or aliens? The saga began in 1989, when a Las Vegas television station conducted an interview with reporter George Knapp with a known man named Bob Lazar. Lazar claimed to have worked as a scientist at a location known as S4, a top-secret United States government location adjacent to the infamous Area 51 on Groom Lake, Nevada. There he saw, worked and witnessed the work of up to 9 fancy aircraft. At first, he thought they were top-secret military experiments, but soon realized that they were something else. These were flying saucers, some authentic and some versions of alien spaceships built by the United States military and reconstructed from captured UFOs. Lazar went on to detail the advanced science of the propulsion system used by these vehicles and describe the elements needed to create the reaction that gives them strange and anti-gravity abilities. He even claimed to have received a briefing explaining in detail the origin of crafts and their creators from extraterrestrials. Curiously, according to Lazar, the aliens hail from the Zeta Reticuli star system, the same supposed neighborhood as the aliens in the Betty and Barney Hill kidnap case. He called them Zeta Reticulans and claimed that they have been visiting this planet since antiquity. It was an amazing story, and this is what many UFO researchers expected. For years they had known that ordinary citizens and contractors worked in Area 51, along with government employees who had flown in from Las Vegas on the infamous Janet airline. Could it be that after all these years, someone connected to Area 51 had to bravely tell them what was going on there? Bob claims to have a master's degree in physics, which he received from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, as well as a master's degree in technology from the California State University of Technology. But when Bob Lazar began to tell the public about secret developments related to UFOs, interested journalists decided to check out Bob himself. It turned out that none of the universities had a graduate with this name listed. No one had heard of him. Why should anyone believe a man who decided to become famous in this way, when the prestigious universities claim that Lazar never had anything to do with them? In his attempt to locate Bob Lazar's alleged master's thesis, developer and tester John Andrews sent out several requests to different universities. After a while, a reply came from John Orth. I can't imagine that MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, can't find the dissertation. But I do assume that the dissertation was made for a secret project and was also classified. There was a man named Robert Krangel who claims to know Lazar and to have attended security meetings with him at Los Alamos. Freelance journalist George Knapp also investigated Lazar's case and managed to find several MIT graduates who remembered Bob. After completing his training, Lazar worked at the Los Alamos National Laboratory, where they also deny that he was their employee. Although in this case there was evidence he was listed as their employee. When this was reported, the lab said that it was some kind of mistake or it was just a namesake. But then how would they explain a 1987 article in the Monitor newspaper about physicist named Robert Lazar of Los Alamos, who was interested in jet engines? Is this newspaper lying, or is it just that interested parties failed to withdraw all issues with this article? It is much easier to clean up the lists of graduates at universities and give clear instructions to their employees. There is no doubt that all information related to a person named Robert Lazar could have been destroyed, erased. For many skeptics, neither the name on the list of employees of the Los Alamos laboratory, he could have been an ordinary contractor, a janitor, at least. No, the article in the newspaper for 1987 is an argument. The Bob Lazar went to court to restore his affiliation to the fact that he is a graduate of the above-mentioned university. At the hearing, the judge indicated that he made a request to government sources and didn't receive the necessary information. The judge must have assumed that government sources would have information about Lazar. But he had never actually worked for the government. It begs a number of questions. How, without being graduate of one of the most prestigious universities, he was recruited to work in one of the most expensive laboratories in the United States? How was he allowed to access expensive equipment without special education? If Bob Lazar was a liar, how could he know for sure that certain classified objects were being test flown at Pappus Lake on Wednesday night? On the specified Wednesday evening, Lazar, along with independent journalist, went to Pappus Lake and they actually observed a glowing round object in the sky. But even then, the hired skeptics got out, claiming that it was an ordinary passenger plane. But the skeptics probably forgot to inform that the territory of Pappus Lake has limited airspace, because it is located on a plot of land, Area 51. And another argument for the authenticity of the video. When the footage was processed, it became clear that the video is not a plane. The object resembles a certain flying machine, resembling a UFO. But did you see this video? If I can, I try to give you a link to watch it. As for me, it is a glowing object, but not a UFO. We can't see anything, the field, the sky, the stars, just object. This is simply light with poor quality, but we are continuing. Combined with Lazar's lack of verifiable arguments, another of his claims about the mysterious element 515 of the periodic table makes us think and believe him. Bob Lazar said that he studied the operation of the reactor of an alien spacecraft that worked on antimatter. The UFO engine was powered by the nuclear force of element 115. This force created a gravitational field capable of compressing space and time. Lazar also claimed that there is some amount of this element obtained from the aliens in Area 51. Back in 1989, everyone was laughing at him. But 15 years later, Russian and American physicists discovered two elements, one of which is 115. Here are some statements of Bob Lazar that cannot fail to interest. interaction of particle and antiparticle and their transformation into some other particles of element 115 creates not only the energy that feeds the ship, but also the gravitational wave that the UFO is able to spread, compressing space, which allows it to move presumably faster than the speed of light. The new physical concepts that Lazar described, which were not obvious to physicists in the 1980s, are now being used by NASA to develop space models with warp engines. Space models, not real aircraft. The government used alien technology for the development of weapons of mass destruction, capable of destroying entire continents. When I first felt a certain force field around the reactor and my hand was repelled by a force similar to that which repels magnets with the same poles, I was really shocked. This sets off the whole chain reaction in the head. If possible, the force fields are possible that can lift any object into the air and do not need jet rockets and giant for this. It means a boom and no economy. You know what I mean, said Bob Lazar.
But that is all for today. Like and subscribe. Leave your comments. It will be more interesting further.